so that you can see what I'm doing. So what we are seeing now is my screen. The discussion item is accounting for government grants. Accounting for government grants. Accounting accounting for government grants, accounting for government. Actually, the standard is IAS 20. That's the standard on government grants. You know, we all know what a grant is. When you are given a grant as a business by government, a grant is basically a financial assistance. That's basically, it's a grant. A government grant is a financial assistance. Government. A financial assistance. Financial assistance. And to firms given to firms by government. Government grant is when the government is saying we want to assist you. Normally there are conditions attached, you know. Normally there are conditions. You can certainly get a government grant for without any condition. You may actually be, conditions may be imposed. The fact that such a grant is coming from a government, it implies that government grants are normally extended to firms or institutions or organizations where government believes that what we are doing is an essential service to the population. You can't get government grants to start a nightclub, no. So government grants, you may get government grants if you're a farmer. You may get government grants if you're a hospital. Suppose you're a hospital and you want to buy a dialysis machine, and the dialysis machine is costing 10 million and you only have 6 million. So government can chip in and give you a grant of 4 million on condition that you acquire that dialysis machine. That is the condition. You get the grant on condition that you proceed to acquire the dialysis machine. So it's so important. Now, there are two main types of government grants. So types of government grants. Types of government grants. Government grants are of two main types. Sorry for that. There is one which is called asset-based grant. Asset-based grant. So this is one of the form of government grant, and there is two account-based grant. Based grant. Now there are other grants which are like grants related to loans. These ones we account for them as financial instruments, like what we have discussed. Suppose government gives you a loan and say, instead of paying interest of 10%, pay a concessional interest of 2%. These you account for them as financial instruments, as we have discussed in the previous topic. Now, asset-based grant. Here is how you account for an asset-based grant. You know, asset, as the name suggests, this is a grant which is extended or given to you in order to acquire an asset. Like what I have said, say Avenues Hospital wants to purchase a dialysis machine. and the machine is going for 10 million, yet the hospital only has 6 million. So government may chip in with a grant. That's an asset-based grant. Now, with this particular grant, there is a accounting policy. So this is asset-based grant, right? And now let us talk about accounting policy. How do you account for this? You account for an asset-based grant. You can choose, actually, on accounting policy, the firm can choose. Firm can choose to, the firm can choose to A, treat the grant as a deduction from the cost of the asset. One of the accounting policies that you can have, you can simply treat the grant as a deduction from the cost of the asset. So what do we do now? If accounting policy is to treat the grant as a deduction from the cost of the asset, so it means on initial measurement, on the day you receive the asset, initial measurement. So I'm using the dialysis machine here, where I am saying the machine, you buy the machine for $10 million, and of the $10 million, you got a grant of $4 million. The grant you got was $4 million. So the issue here is, how do you treat this grant? You choose. If the accounting policy is to treat the grant as a deduction from the cost of the asset, On the date you buy this particular asset, here's how you go about it. You debit. What is what you do? You receive the grant. So what you do is you debit bank with 4 million, because that's the grant you receive. And then you credit. You debit the bank, and then you credit PPE. $4 million. Are you not seeing it? Because you have treated the grant as a deduction from cost. So from this, it means the carrying amount, of the asset, the carrying amount of the machine, carrying amount of the machine at acquisition becomes 10 million minus grant 4 million, which is equals to 6 million. Sorry. Hello. All right. Again, go phone line, Mama. It was not room meeting. Go phone line after 2 hours. So the carrying amount of the machine at acquisition becomes 10 million minus 4 million. That becomes the carrying amount. Are you not seeing that? That's what you do if you treat the grant as a deduction from cost. It means as soon as you have acquired the asset, even if you paid 10 million, the cost is net of the grant. So let us now have subsequent measurement. subsequent measurement. Subsequent measurement. Oh, sorry. Hello? Simba. Oh, okay. Can you send me a WhatsApp message so that I sent you the information? I'm in a lecture. Okay, so subsequent measurement. You know, by subsequent measurement, we are saying, after you had initially accounted for the government grant, you now know that if you treat the grant as a deduction from cost, the cost of the grant is now 6 million instead of 10 million because you were given a grant of 4 million. So subsequent measurement, it means how much then do you recognize in the statement of financial position and the amount you recognize in the statement of profit or loss at reporting date. You get that? Now at the year end. So what you simply do is the firm depreciates the asset. The asset assists systematic assists. Normally, systematic basis, it's normally the straight line. Normally, straight line. If the examiner says reducing balance is still fine. Normally, straight line over the useful life of the asset. I mean, depreciates the asset on a systematic basis, normally straight line, on the reduced cost of the asset, on the reduced cost of the asset. In that, you depreciate the asset based on the reduced cost of the asset. So when you are depreciating the asset going forward, you are depreciating the 6 million. Please pay attention to this. So let's say this is a useful life. Suppose this is a useful life. Suppose the useful life was 4 years. Of the asset was 4 years. You are now depreciating this on the 6 million. So e.g. And at the end of year one, suppose you now want to know what happens at the end of year one, you say depreciation charge to profit or loss, it will be 6 million over 4 years, 6 million over 4 years, which is equals 6 divided by 4. So this is the depreciation charge to profit or loss, and then PPE in the statement of financial position, SOFP, what would be your PPE? 6 million, because it was 6 million, though you purchased it for 10, remember you reduced the grant, minus depreciation of 0.15 million, which is equal, so your PPE becomes 6 million minus the depreciation. You get it. So you proceed to do that. You proceed to do that until you get to the year end. Now, Ngwenya, Rufaro, the accounting entries I have done here, they work with this accounting treatment. If you choose the accounting policy of treating the grant as a deduction from cost, this is what you do. If the accounting policy is to treat the grant as a deduction from cost, Because I said the firm can choose. So you'll be told by the examiner, what is it that the firm has opted to do? Now, the grant can be, you can treat the grant as deferred income. Or you can say, or treat the grant as deferred, grant as deferred income. This is another accounting policy. This time, the grant is not being treated as a deduction from cost. Rather, the grant is being treated as deferred income. So let me copy the information on the grant again. Because this is the information we are using. Let us say you are treating the grant as deferred income. How do you go about it? Well, meaning this grant is no longer being treated as a deduction from cost. No. What you are going to treat the grant is you are treating it as income received in advance. So how do you go about it? You say initial measurement. Meaning on the date you receive the grant, what are your accounting entries? That's what we mean by initial measurement. You debit bank. You know, each time you receive the grant, because it's the money you are receiving, so you debit the bank. And then you credit government grant or deferred income. Credit. This time you don't credit the asset because you are not treating it as a deduction from cost. Rather, you credit government grant account. Government grant. This is like deferred income. Deferred income we are referring to. So you credit that deferred income. There you go. If you the cost of your machine remains 10 million this time. So the cost of the machine is not affected. It remains 10 million. The cost of the machine, cost of the machine is not affected by, is not affected by the government grant. Not affected by the government grant yet. And it remains 10 million. This works if the grant is treated as deferred income. If the grant doesn't affect anything to do with machine, it goes to deferred income account. Now, what happens with subsequent measurement? Now know what subsequent measurement is. It means having chosen this accounting treatment, how then do you report these figures in the statement of financial position and in the statement of profit or loss at reporting date? That's subsequent now, subsequent measurement. Because, you know, by deferred income, we are simply saying income received in advance. That's what it means. You receive the government grant and you treat it as income received in advance. That's what it means. So it's like I give you 4 million as income, but this time it's covering 4 years. We call that deferred income. And clearly, if you receive income which is covering 4 years and you receive it all at once, it's a liability. It's a liability because you are yet to satisfy the condition for you to say you have earned income. As time passes now, you'll be taking a portion of income for that year from deferred income to other income. Let me repeat. You get a government grant of 4 million covering 4 years. Clearly, that's a non-current liability because it's received in advance. But as the years go by, you'll be taking a portion of income for that year from deferred income to other income. So you'll be reducing a liability and crediting profit or loss with the portion of income for that year. And the process of doing so is called amortization of government grant. That is called amortization of government grant. So it will be like this. If you treat it as other income, subsequent measurement will go like this. You say the firm amortizes the grant. The firm amortizes the grant to other income on a straight line basis, over the useful life of the asset, I want to show you what I'm saying. This is the grant. So you have got year 1, 2, 3, 4. These are 4 years of the grant. So you amortize the grant to profit or loss over the useful life of the asset. So you say a carrying amount at start. Is that a question? Let me check. Oh, someone is saying, is it? Ah, well, it's credit. It was a typing error there. I said debit bank credit government grant. It's not debit government grant. Thanks. You know, that shows that we are together. Because I said you debit bank, so I wanted to type credit government grant, not debit government grant. Mm-hmm. You know, why am I saying credit? As you can see from my explanations, I am saying this is a liability, so it's a credit. Now, notice, you now have amortization of government grant. So what we have is opening balance, and then transfer to profit or loss. And then closing balance. That's how you amortize the government grant. Opening balance, transfer to profit or loss, and then what? closing balance. Let me show you how it goes. So you do it like this. The grant was 4 million. That was the opening balance. And then profit or loss, it is equals 4 million divided by 4 years. So in profit or loss, you are going to transfer 4 million divided by 4. Then closing balance becomes this minus transfer to profit or loss. Are you getting that? Now, so there you go. Now, the closing balance for year one is the opening for year two. The closing for year one is the opening for year two, so that it works like this. Are you not seeing that? No wonder why we say you amortize the grant to profit or loss. That's what we really mean. Every year you'll be amortizing the grant to profit or loss. So that's what you do. Then another issue is the firm also analyzes the closing balance of the grant into current portion into current liability portion, current liability portion, portion, and non-current liability portion. Current liability portion and non-current liability portion. I shall show you how this is done. The closing balance in the government grant, you have to analyze it into current liability portion and non-current liability portion. Also, you may say if we choose this accounting policy, we depreciate the asset at what amount? At 10 million or at 6 million? Remember, we said the cost of the asset is made 10 million. So you depreciate 10 million this time. The asset depreciated on the original cost. The asset is depreciated on the original cost. On the original cost. So if we say statement of profit or loss extract for year one, statement of profit or loss extract for year one. Let's say you are preparing statement of profit or loss for year one. Here is how you do it. Statement of profit or loss extract for year one. Sorry. You say other income. Income, because remember I said you are amortizing the grant to other income. So other income, you have other income which is called government grant. So what you take and post to other income is 100,000. That's what you post to other income. And you also have expenses. You know, let's say admin expenses, or let us just say expenses. In respect of this, amongst the expenses is depreciation. Depreciation, which is 10 million divided by 4 years. Notice, because you treat the grant as other income, depreciation is on the original cost of the asset. So it's 10 million over 4. You'll be seeing these questions, examiner saying, what will be the net charge to profit or loss? The question may say, what will be the net charge to profit or loss in respect of the grant? So the net charge will be depreciation minus grant. So it will be 150. Or what will be the income recognized in profit or loss in respect of the grant? It will be 100,000. And then statement of financial position extract. Statement of financial position extract is at end of year one. Is it end of year one? What would be the statement of financial position extract? Notice, end of year one, the statement of financial position extract will be like this. Non-current assets will be 10 million minus depreciation, which is 0.25 million. You get 7,500,000. 1, 2, 3. That's your non-current asset. And then you have non-current liabilities. non-current liabilities. I want you to notice something concerning non-current liabilities. Non-current liability in this case is the deferred income, meaning the government grant is the non-current liability. So what we have done here is amortization of government grant. This table is amortization of, this is amortization of government grant. That's what this table is about. So when we say non-current liability end of year one, please pay attention to this point I'm going to say to talk about. The closing liability for government grant is 3 million end of year one. Not, it's 3 million end of year one. That's the closing liability for the government grant. But you know that within the 3 million, there is a portion of 100,000 which is to be apportioned within a year to profit or loss. So that portion, which is within the 3 million, which you must credit to profit or loss within 12 months, is called the current liability portion. Let me repeat. End of year one, the closing balance is 3 million. So that's the liability. But are you noticing that within the 3 million, there is 1 million which you must credit to profit or loss in the coming 12 months. It is within the 3 million. So that portion which you must take out within the next 12 months is called a current liability portion within that liability. So you have to split the 3 million into 1 million current portion and 2 million non-current portion. If you understood that, can you type in the chat if you have understood that part? So you say current portion and non-current portion, you say government grant. Please type in the chat if you have understood what I've just said. So it's 3 million minus 1 million, which you should transfer in the next 12 months. So non-current portion becomes 2 million. Then the current portion, then you say current liabilities, it's still the same grant, current liabilities, which is, you then say government grant again, and you take the current portion. This now is the current portion, which is 1 million. So this now makes up the balance end of year one. It now makes up the balance end of year one. So it's fine. So if you are getting what I'm saying, then it's perfect. So this is how you account for the government grant, if the accounting policy is to treat the grant as other income. If the accounting policy is to treat the grant as deferred income, sorry, this is how you account for it up to year. So that is what I was illustrating. Right? So there you go. So you may say, can you bring me up to speed? What is it that we have done? We are discussing asset-based grant. And we are saying when it comes to asset-based grant, there are two accounting policies, and a firm can choose either of them. The first accounting policy is to treat the grant as a deduction from cost of the asset. Here is how you proceed. I have showed you that. The second accounting policy is to treat the grant as deferred income. This is how you proceed. I have showed you that. So we are done with asset-based grants. Now let us look at income-based grants. Income-based grants. Now, And income-based grants, these are grants which has nothing to do with assets. That's basically the definition. Grants which have nothing to do with assets are called income-based grants. These are grants which have nothing to do with assets, meaning they are any grant which not an asset based grant. Any grant which is not an asset based grant is called income based grant. So you may say, give us an example. For an asset-based grant, we understood it. Can you give us an example of an income-based grant? It's like this. Let's say you, and are you not seeing nowadays that doctors, like in Zim, doctors are in short supply. So the hospital, like Bains or Avenues, may say they need neurosurgeons, but they can't afford the salary for a neurosurgeon. So what do they do? Suppose they need 5 neurosurgeons, and they need these for 6 years. So government may say, we can chip in with a grant, we meet halfway. So what it means is, if the salaries for neurosurgeons is 10 million, for example, government may say, we pay you 5 million and then you pay the balance, or we give you a grant of 6 million and then you pay the 4 million and we hire the 5 neurosurgeons for 4 years or for whatever condition. As I told you, there are conditions attached to government grants. So as with our illustration before, for you to understand, it is prudent that we give an example. Let's say the hospital need 5 doctors. 5 doctors. Yes. 5 doctors for 4 years. And their salary is $10 million. Salary is $10 million, 5 doctors for 4 years. And then government gives you a grant. Gives you a grant of 6 million on condition that you retain the doctors for you get a grant of 6 million. Condition for the grant. Condition being, you have to retain these doctors for how many years? Condition being to hire and retain doctors for 4 years. To hire and retain the doctors for 4 years. That's the condition. So we want to see, how would you account for this income-based grant? As with asset-based grant, there are 2 main accounting policies that you can choose. Accounting policies. The accounting policy number one is, let's say the firm can choose, it is a choice. As with asset-based grant, A, treat the grant as a deduction from related expense. The related expense. if we are treating the grant as a deduction from the related expense in expense in this case is salaries and wages, that is deduct from salaries and wages. Salaries and wages. So what you do, if you are treating the grant as a deduction from the related expense, initial measurement, meaning on the date you receive the grant, what are your accounting entries? On the date you get the grant, what you do, so this one is so important. This one is so important. What you do on the date you receive the grant, you debit bank. Notice, whenever you receive money, you debit bank and you credit government grant account. Government grant. You credit the government grant account. This is a liability account. And then what then do you do as part of subsequent measurement? Subsequent measurement, you then reduce salaries and wages with a portion of grant which is attributable to for that year. That's subsequent measurement. Subsequent measurement. Reduce salaries and wages in this case. Notice I'm saying salaries and wages because this example I've given is about salaries of doctors. If it was another expense, no wonder why we are just saying a related expense. It does not mean to be salaries and wages always. And it's so subsequent measurement is you amortize the grant. Amortize the grant by reducing salaries and wages with the portion of the grant for each year, by reducing salaries and wages with the portion of the grant for each year. Let's say when I said five doctors, their total salary is, let me say salary is actually 2 million per year, so that you understand. I had given the total salary, let me give it as annual salary. So what we are saying is you amortize the grant. So you need to have a grant amortization like what we have done here. Copy. And you bring it here. So I have my grant amortization here, but the grant is 6 million. And it's over 4 years, but it's 6 million over four. 6 million over four. You can see it is amortized. So this is not transfer to profit or loss. It's actually transfer to salaries and wages. Salaries and wages. So what does this mean? What does this mean? It means salaries and wages for year one, salaries and wages for year one. If you want to find salaries and wages for year one, you say 2 million, because it's 2 million for the five doctors, minus the grant which is amortized, which is 1.5 million. So salaries and wages for year one becomes 500,000 equals 2 million minus the grant. No wonder why we are saying treat the grant as a deduction from the related expense. treat the grant as a deduction from the related expense. In this case, the related expense is salaries and wages. So every year, you'll be reducing salaries and wages with that particular portion of the grant. And then, current liability or non-current liabilities, non-current liabilities. Remember, there is current. You have to allocate to analyze the grant into current portion and non-current portion. So, non-current liabilities, you say government grant. You now understand that you come to this end of year one. This is the grant, 4.5 million. But you know that within the 4.5 million, there is 1.5 million which is to be deducted within the next 12 months. So the non-current portion of the grant, it becomes 4.5 minus 1.5, minus 1.5. So the non-current portion equals 3 million. Then you come to current liabilities. What you are being taught, what I'm teaching you here is called, this is called application of the standards. Don't think that the question will come like this. They will give you a question and just say, prepare the statement of profit or loss and the statement of financial position. But among the notes, you'll be given an issue of grant. So I'm teaching you how you then treat that grant and how you present that grant in the financial statement. This one is so important. Right. Are you not seeing this? What I'm doing here is for year one. This is just for year one. If it's for year two, you proceed and do the same. Now you can see when we are doing for year three, is there still any non-current portion? If you are for year three, there's no more non-current portion. Because for year three, whatever is left is to be amortized in the next 12 months. So for year three, non-current portion is zero, but current portion is 1.5. So this is how you treat, if your accounting policy is to treat an income-based grant as a deduction from cost, this is how you proceed. I'm sure you understand that. That's accounting policy number one for an income-based grant. If you choose to treat the grant as a deduction from the related expense. Now, let me copy this question again and come to another accounting policy. Let me put it here. Now, let us say the accounting policy, which is OB. Say the accounting policy is to treat the grant as deferred income. You can treat this grant as deferred income, even if it's income-based grant. The only difference with this is when you treat it as a deduction from cost, from related expense, you in the profit or loss, you reduce salaries and wages, meaning you reduce the related expense. But if you treat the grant as other income, it's equally the same, only that in the statement of profit or loss, instead of crediting salaries and wages, you are now crediting other income. So initial measurement, so there you go. Meaning, on the date you receive the grant, what do? You debit bank. I make no mistake, each time you receive the grant, you receive money, you debit bank, and then you credit government grant, which is other income, which is deferred income, sorry. That's what you do. Then, so this time, salaries for doctors will not be affected. The salaries for doctors will remain 2 million. So it's subsequent measurement now. In subsequent measurement, this is how then you proceed subsequently. Subsequently, you then proceed like this. You, you then amortize the grant to other income over the condition, over the period associated with the grant. So that's what you simply do. Amortize the grant, or the firm amortize the firm. Firm amortizes the grant to other income, this time not over the useful life of the asset, but over the conditional period of the grant. Conditional period of the grant. So if the grant is for 4 years, you hire doctors for 4 years, you are going to amortize the grant over 4 years. So you come with amortization table. It is still the same as what we have here. Grant amortization is still the same. Grant. So let me copy everything here so that I just edit a little bit. Copy. So it is still the same. You have your grant amortization. But here, what changes, what just changed is you are no longer transferring to profit or loss. You are transferring to salaries and wages. You are transferring to other income. Other income. That's where you are transferring. So in the statement of profit or loss, you are now saying other income. You are no longer saying salaries and wages. Other income. Other income. It's now, let me insert a line here so that you can follow through. You now say, so this is now statement of profit or loss. Statement of profit or loss, end of year one. End of year one. This is now statement of profit or loss, end of year one. This is how you are now going to proceed. You are now saying other income. You take the full grant, which was amortized, 1.5. And then salaries and wages will remain 2,000. Salaries and wages will still remain 2,000 because we are not 2 million, sorry. We are not treating the grant as a deduction from related expense. We are taking salaries and wages as it is, and it's a minus because it's an expense. It's a minus because it's an expense there. That's your salaries and wages. And then, in the statement of financial position, like SOFP, at end of year one, SOFP at end of year one, it doesn't change. There's still current portion and non-current portion of the liabilities. Current portion and non-current portion. It will still remain the same. All right. So this is how you proceed. Should you choose to treat the grant as other income? Should you choose to treat income-based grant as other income? So these are the only two accounting policies. Treat it as other income or treat it as a deduction from the related expense. Right. So you have understood this, and I'm sure I have explained it in a manner that is so legible. And let us now say repayment of government grants. Of government before repayment of government grant repayment of government grant, should you choose to repay the government grant. Now, there are circumstances and events which may warrant the government grants to be repaid. The chief among them is the issue that whenever you get a government grant, it's conditional. There is a condition attached to the government grant. So if you breach the condition which was attached to the government grant, you may need to repay it. That one is so important. And then how then do we treat repayment of a government grant? That's a second question. You know, repayment of a government grant is treated as a change in accounting estimate, not as a change in accounting policy. I'm sure those who have done F3, you know what these are. Julie, do you still remember how do we treat a change in accounting estimate? Yes, perhaps the audio is acting up, Julie. Well, I can see you're trying to say something. Rufar, can you assist Julie? She's saying something, but the audio is acting up. How do we treat an accounting estimate? Okay. You guys, you don't want to talk to yourself. It's still fine. Let me talk to you then. You know, your silence is of such, you know, silence is your silence, Mr. Ngwenya, is of such nature that you are saying, say, it appears we are moving very well. Where is this coming from now? Isn't it so? Okay. Repayment of government grant. So, I'm typing here. Repayment of government grant is accounted for as a change in accounting estimate, or is treated. Repayment of government grant is treated as a change in accounting estimate. Treated as a change in accounting estimate. Repayment of government grant is treated as a change in accounting estimate. Now you may ask and say, what do we mean a change in accounting estimate? A change in accounting estimate. By this, we are saying it is applied prospectively from the beginning. It is applied prospectively. Applied prospectively. Prospectively. From the beginning of the year in which repayment is made. Of the year in which repayment. So I told you, if you breach a condition, you may be asked to repay the grant. You apply it prospectively, not retrospectively. Are we together? You don't, suppose the grant is repaid in year three. You don't go back to adjust accounts from year one to year three, no. It just affects year three going forward. In other words, records for year three going forward will be of such nature that there was no grant at all. You ensure that you adjust your records from year three going forward to ensure that as if there was no grant. That is if it was a full repayment. If you are asked to pay half, records from year three going forward, you just consider them as if you have half of the grant. That's record for year three going forward. Then another is, you know, I'm sure I need to. I have noticed your silence, guys, when I asked change in accounting estimate and change in accounting policy. Your silence was so deafening. It tells me that perhaps you have forgotten this stuff. Let me take this opportunity to perhaps define for you what an accounting estimate is. Accounting estimate. Have an accounting estimate, and we do have an accounting policy. Accounting policy. You know, when you learn stuff, don't forget. Don't use FIFO in when it comes to school to say the first things you learn are the first things you forget. No, first in learning, becoming first out in forgetting. No, that's not good. Now, an accounting estimate affects it normally affects the amount. It affects the amount reported in the financial statement. Financial statement. Oh, I wanted to say change in. I just say accounting. I wanted to say change in. Change in accounting estimate. It affects the amount reported in the financial statement. And here I also wanted to say change in accounting policy. It affects also something else. So change in accounting estimate affects the amount reported in the financial statements. Let me just say FS. E.g. Examples are changing the useful life of the asset. Changing life of the asset. That can affect depreciation figure. This is a change in accounting estimate. Even repayment of government grant. It's a change in accounting estimate. Issues to do with changing from straight line to reducing balance method. Changing from straight line using balance method. All these are changes in accounting estimate. How do we go about these? They are prospectively adjusted, you know? They are applied prospectively. Applied prospectively from the beginning of the year, in which the change is made. From the beginning of the year in which a year of change. So you have that. That's an accounting policy. You know, I'm accounting estimate. Why I'm doing this is because I realized you guys, you were so silent when I asked. This is something we assume you know. And that it's actually in accordance with IAS 8, this is the standard which talks about changes in accounting estimate, errors, etc. IAS 8, right? And then let us now talk about a change in accounting policy. A change in accounting policy affects presentation. It affects presentation, classification. classification of reported amounts of reported items. Accounting policy. It affects classification of that's one thing. E.g. examples. When you are talking about a change in accounting policy, you are talking about e.g. including depreciation in cost of sales, including depreciation or charging depreciation in cost of sales. That's a change in accounting policy because classification is affected. Another is it also includes changes in basis of valuation, includes changes valuation basis. That's also a change in accounting policy. E.g. Changing from FIFO. AFCO, average cost inventory valuation basis. This is now a base. If you are changing the basis, it's a change in accounting policy. Even option to treat grant as a deduction from option to treat asset-based grant as a deduction from the cost of the asset. So if you have this, again, it's a change in accounting policy. And now, how do we account for change in accounting policy? These are applied. These are applied retrospectively. Right. Okay, sorry for that. These are applied retrospectively. What do we mean? If you choose to charge depreciation in cost of sales, you need to go back to change also all the financial statements which are comparable to that particular file. So if we have got 3-year financial statements and this year we decide to charge depreciation in cost of sales, we need to retrospectively adjust all the 3-year financial statements. By retrospective meaning going back and adjust. If you don't mind, allow me to perhaps open a question. Open a question and then where is it? Looking for a question here. I take my have you noticed something? when you're doing the knots, have you noticed at the end of the knots that I gave you, at the end of the knots, I did what is called question paper analysis. Can you imagine, Julie? I was going through all past papers to tell you that this question I've asked you, these knots were asked, were examined in this question, these knots were examined in this question, and you have all these questions in your revision kits. But it tells you that the effort I put to this, can you imagine, not just a single subject, 9 ACCA subjects doing that. I know all the questions, every question that is of ACCA from 2008 to date. I went through every question. Would you do that? Not like say you have got plenty of free time. I am very busy. Those who know me, you know me, that I'm very busy. But can you imagine the devotion I give to this, which is exactly what I want you also to do. So you now know all these questions on impairment of assets, all these questions, they are equally illustrated in our okay, let me open another. Right. So question number 3, this is September 2016. I also gave you this question in the notes. It's there in my notes. Just if you open the notes on government grants, you'll see it. On 1 January 2006, garden bugs received a grant of 30 million, received a 30,000 grant relating to equipment which cost 90,000. So the grant is 30,000, equipment costs 90,000. And it has a useful life of 6 years. The grant was netted off against cost of equipment. So this is the accounting treatment which they used, meaning they treat the grant as a deduction from cost. That's what it means when they say the grant was netted off. The grant was netted off against the cost of the equipment. Now, on 1 January 2007, when the equipment had a carrying amount of 50,000, its use was changed so that it was no longer being used in accordance with the grant. This meant that the grant needed to be repaid in full by 31 December 2007. This had not yet been done, so they breached the condition. And once they breached the condition, they are now supposed to repay the grant, and we are being told that it's not yet been done. Now, which journal entry is required to reflect the correct accounting treatment for the government grant and the equipment in the financial statements for the year ended 31 December 2007? Now, notice they need to repay the grant. So don't make a mistake. There is a liability there of 30,000. Because they need to repay the grant, so there's a liability of 30,000. So here's the deal. I just want to show you how you proceed. So we have cost of asset, cost of asset. Cost of the asset is 90,000. And then we say less the grant. Less grant. This one is initial measurement. This is done at initial measurement. Cost of the asset less the grant. I want you to see how we go about it. Cost of the asset less the grant of 30,000 minus 30. So you have the carrying amount of the asset being 60. This is now the carrying amount. Now with 60, it means depreciation was how much? So depreciation. The asset was 1 January 2006, and now we are talking of 31 December 2007. So depreciation. Depreciation was this one over 6 years, 60,000 divided by 6, because it is a life of 6 years. So this was depreciation with the grant. Now, the need to repay the grant arose in 31 December 2007. And I said, this is a change in accounting estimate. And I said, it is applied prospectively from the beginning of the year of change. From the beginning. So this is applied from 2007. So in 2007, the grant is to be repaid. The grant is paid. So we prospectively calculate depreciation as if we prospectively depreciate as if we had no grant. The asset if you had no grant. So depreciation becomes depreciation for 20x7 90,000 divided by 6. So depreciation for 20x7 becomes 90 for 6 years. So it's 15,000. It's 15,000. So what it means is, notice what it means. What it means is we need to reverse the grant. The cost of the asset is no longer 60, because we need to treat the grant as if it was not there from 2007 onwards. So what are the journal entries? Are you not seeing that in 2006 there was a shortfall of depreciation of 5,000? Because in 2006 we still had a grant. There was a shortfall of 5,000. In 2007, depreciation without the grant is 15,000. But we are saying we repaid the grant. So this effect of a shortfall in depreciation for 2006, we don't go back to 2006 and change 2006 accounts. No. Because we said it is applied prospectively, meaning we now know that in 2006 there was a shortfall of 5,000 on depreciation. But this shortfall, we don't go back to 2006 and adjust it. Rather, this shortfall affects 2007 accounts going forward. That is called prospective application. You don't go back to 2006, but you acknowledge the shortfall, But you bring the shortfall to 20x7. So you say shortfall in depreciation for 20x6. Shortfall in depreciation for 20x6. You don't go back to 20x6 and adjust. Rather, you come back to 20x7 and adjust. So total depreciation in 20x7 is 20,000. That becomes depreciation charge for 20x7. Total depreciation charge in 20x7. What name then is given to this 5,000, which we are saying shortfall in depreciation? Which it was a shortfall in 20x6, but we did not go to 20x6 and adjust. Rather, we adjusted 20x7. This is called change in accounting estimate. A change in accounting estimate. This is what we are talking for when we are saying prospective application, meaning we don't go back, but it affects this year's accounts going forward. So what is then the double entry? The double entry is debit profit or loss. You debit profit or loss with depreciation, which is 20,000. Which is 20,000. And then remember, you are told that the grant is yet to be repaid, so it's a liability. Liability, which is the grant, which is yet to be. Grand is 30,000. Because the cost of the asset is no longer 60 as before. We are now